meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Before we get into the actual sermon, how many of you were aware that the Episcopal Church made the news this week? Yeah, I sort of saw it too. If you get your news only from the secular media and you believe that you have been kicked out of the Anglican Communion, let me correct that immediately. No such thing happened. Yes, the primates met. Primates being the sort of the presiding bishops of the different provinces across the worldwide Anglican Communion. They asked that five people no longer come to meetings for a period of 3 years. I don't know about you, but if I'm told I don't have to come to a committee meeting anymore, I'm good. It's all right. Now, I will also admit that my first knee-jerk reaction to all of this was to say, does this mean I no longer have to pray for the Anglican cycle of prayer? I'm like, good, because most of those names we stumble upon. And then I remembered what Jesus said about who I'm supposed to be praying for. Those who dislike me, persecute me, and utter all sorts of nonsense because I'm following Jesus. So to me, I'm like, yep, Anglican cycle of prayer stays. Beyond the fact that, no, we haven't been kicked out. I also thought to myself, as I looked at the gospel, I said, you know, in thinking about this, I hear the words of Jesus to his mother at the wedding in Cana of Galilee. What has this to do with me? Honestly, nothing and everything. Nothing, because at St. Luke's Metuchen, in the Diocese of New Jersey, in the Protestant Episcopal Church of the United States, nothing changes. The directions and decisions that have been made are not going to be reversed. We will continue to be an inclusive community that welcomes all, regardless of race, gender, class, sexual orientation, anything you can name. Doors are open at all times. But we also have to remember that our brothers and sisters who live in very different contexts, in confronting things that we can't even imagine, have to go back to be able to say they took a stance. This 3-year period gives everybody breathing room. And we all agreed, and I invite you, go read the actual communique out of the meeting. Not what CNN, not what Fox News, not what the New York Times says it means. Read the actual document. You will see a gracious desire to walk together, even in very, what's the word I want? Never mind. Disagree. That's all I need to say. But today's gospel isn't about that, is it? First off, we're hearing a gospel we get to hear once every 3 years. Wedding at Cana in Galilee. Year C. I told you you'd like year C. And we hear this wonderful miracle. A miracle that church, of course, how many have been to a wedding? If you've been to one, you will notice that at the beginning of the prayer book, it says that Jesus blessed these marriages by his presence and first miracle at a wedding in Cana of Galilee. I'm not sure that that's what Jesus was doing there. He got invited. That's a good thing. All weddings should start by inviting Jesus to them, whether they be heterosexual marriages or homosexual marriages. Inviting Christ into a new relationship is a good idea. Doesn't guarantee it'll work, but it's always a great place to start. And ultimately, how many don't like the fact that Jesus kept the party going? Because once the booze is done, the party's over, everybody goes home. The idea, of course, isn't that at all. The symbolism is much deeper to me. How many of you have ever felt like that empty jar? Not sure what you're doing, what your purpose really is. Nothing's actually changed. You're still sort of going your day-to-day routine. But you know there should be something more. Something deeper. And the only way that changes is by Christ being present and you inviting him to do something you don't expect him to do. So, there's that great mother-son thing, and she says, do whatever he says. That's good advice for Christians. Do what Jesus tells you to do. Follow the instructions carefully and allow the grace of God to work a miracle in your life in ways you wouldn't have imagined. Most of us know that when we start something, we like to begin full force,
doing our best right from the start.
But then a little later down the road, things start, the energy level starts to peter out, and perhaps our best efforts aren't there in the end. We're barely making it across the line. But the story of the gospel today is different, isn't it? It talks about the best coming at the end. Who sang that song, Saving the Best for Last? Was that Whitney Houston? I don't remember. But there is a song that talks about that, that you give the best for last. Your top shelf stuff comes out at the end, not in the beginning. What if we, at St. Luke's, were to say, Lord, we are looking for new wine. We're looking for ways to do something exciting and different that's unexpected. How can you bless us? How can you help us to be more than we can ask or imagine? More than just an empty stone jar, but instead, something that gets filled up and changed in ways that are exciting and dynamic and make people want to keep coming to the party and keeping it going. That, to me, is the miracle of Cana. It's not about blessing certain types of weddings. It's about Christ's presence in lives and changing them for the better, bringing out the best in us, hopefully at the end, but perhaps even all along the way. But the only way this can happen is Christ being invited in. The wedding at Cana miracle would not have happened if Christ had not been invited in the first place. He's not a wedding crasher. You have to bring him in. And when we do that, no matter whether we're feeling filled to the brim or a bit empty, the presence of Jesus is the only thing I've ever found that can make gracious actions happen. Amen.
Amen.